deep underwater, 4 kilometers down, beyond the reach of our star's light, lie these dark, potato-shaped nodules. They've been there for millions of years, slowly growing in size, and these oddly shaped bulbs may hold the key to an electric future. We have known about these formations for over 150 years. In 1873, HMS Challenger even managed to collect samples from the mysterious abyss of the Midnight Zone, dropping kilometer-long hemp ropes with a collecting apparatus attached and by chance pulling one of these nodules to the surface. Each of these lumps contain metals that can help solve one of modern day's greatest supply chain issues, battery production, containing manganese, cobalt, nickel, and copper, and they are scattered all over the vast seafloor. It is estimated that a patch of land just over the size of Ireland can yield over 54 million tons of metals, collectively worth over $20 billion. Since their discovery, they've served as no more than interesting seafloor features, given that the precious metal they contain can be mined on land. There has been no incentive to profit off mining the nodules. But with growing supply chain woes and growing competition in the electric vehicle market, dozens of companies now seek innovative ways to surface these nodules. We know frighteningly little about the deep sea floor. As you descend past 1,000 meters, all light disappears, and thus, so does all photosynthesis. The only light that may be visible is the faint twinkling of bioluminescence. Without sunlight, food becomes extremely scarce, and animals rely on what is called marine snow, the falling debris of organic material from shallower waters. Because of these extreme conditions, the creatures in deep water have evolved to be some of the most unique in the animal kingdom. At 4,000 meters, you may find a semi-translucent Dumbo octopus scuttling along, or gulper eels with massive expandable gullets, or a viperfish with its terrifying dead eyes and unbelievably sharp teeth. Deeper still, scavengers and detritivores scramble across the bottom, looking for any morsel of food they can find. Animals like this have been found as deep as 11,000 meters at the bottom of the deepest parts of ocean. ROVs and some manned missions are beginning to scratch the surface, exploring the depths of the sea, but it is no easy feat. Only 4 crewed missions have ever been to the bottom of the Mariana Trench, the deep sea being one of the last ecosystems on this Earth that has been largely untouched by humans. This raises major concerns for the impact any mining operation will have on the strange and wonderful life residing among these metal-rich deposits. Early investigations of the seafloor in the 1960s and 70s revealed that the nodules are clustered in certain areas of the seafloor. Their locations depend highly on environmental factors, needing high oxygenation levels and a source of metal in the seawater or seabed to grow. Similar to how iron in steel reacts with oxygen and water to create a layer of rust, nodules are formed in layers of oxidized metal. For a nodule to form, a piece of debris has to sink into the oxygen-rich environment of the deep sea floor. From above, free-flowing iron and manganese ions dissolved in water react with the oxygen and form layers. These form nodules at the surface of the seafloor. From below, the metals get pushed up by concentration gradients through the porous sediment, and once they reach the oxygen-rich environment, they react and start forming nodules 10 to 15 centimeters below the surface. Depending on their depth, different percentages of metal will be present. While the majority of the metals in the nodules are manganese and iron, surface nodules are exposed to more cobalt, while deeper nodules collect more lithium and nickel. These layers form at astonishingly low rates, around 1 to 10 millimeters per million years. In the time it took our ancestors to spread out from Africa and dominate the world, these nodules only grew the width of a human hair. Scientists can predict where these nodules would appear based on these environmental effects, and we have confirmed that they appear in higher concentrations in the Pacific and Indian Oceans. Most of these zones fall under international waters, so the UN set up the International Seabed Authority in 1994, based in Kingston, Jamaica, to organize and control all mineral-related activities related to the seabed. Up to now, they have not granted any licenses for mining operations, but they have granted permission to a total of 19 exploratory missions of these polymetallic nodules, of which 16 are based in the Clarion-Clipperton Zone, or CCZ, an area just off the coast of Mexico. Each of these missions cover an area of about 75,000 square kilometers, approximately 0.16% of the area of the CCZ. Estimations for the potential yield of a mine this large are expected to be about 1.5 million tons of wet nodules per year. A typical electric battery has 35 kilograms of nickel, 20 kilograms of manganese, and 14 kilograms of cobalt. A mine this large would provide enough nickel for 400,000 car batteries, enough manganese for 18 million, and enough cobalt for 100,000 cars per year. The value of these deposits is undeniable, but we've never extracted solid minerals at scale from the seafloor before. This is going to require new technologies, and unsurprisingly, many borrow from the oil and gas industry, who are all too familiar with extracting value from the deep sea. Companies first have to locate a region where the density of these nodules is large enough to make extraction worthwhile. Autonomous submarines are first sent down to assess the area, using pulses of sound to scan and map the seafloor. The resolution of these scanners is too low to directly detect individual nodules, which are usually about 10 centimeters in size, but they can estimate the density of the nodules on the seafloor before sending down another expedition to collect physical samples. Now comes the difficult part, extraction. Many different solutions have been proposed, and there are several problems to overcome. Some trials were conducted in the 1970s and 80s, and the knowledge gained in these trials all led to the same proposals for a mining method. A self-propelled rover would be lowered to the seafloor, attached to a surface ship through a rigid riser and a flexible pipe. These risers are technologies created by the oil and gas industry and are well developed. Once the collecting rover touches down on the seafloor, it can move around, remotely operated from above. The rover effectively acts like a potato harvester, but instead of combing through the soil, most rovers use a water jet to dislodge the nodules and push them into the collector. Now, we need a way to transport the material to the surface, and this is where most of the technological issues are found. Once the nodules are dislodged, the collectors carry the sludge and nodules through a separator. The unwanted liquid gets expelled behind the collector, causing a plume of dirt to trail behind the rover. The leftover slurry with debris and nodules are now pumped up. Things get a little difficult here. Raising material over a distance this large requires a great deal of energy. However, attaching some kind of rope to raise material isn't easily scaled. Pumping liquid oil is vastly easier than transporting solid materials. Currently, two main mechanisms have been proposed to bring the nodules up to the surface. One way is to pump compressed air into the pipe, which creates the necessary pressure underneath the raw material to lift it to the surface. However, this method has a very low energy efficiency at about 15%. The second option is to space out submersible centrifugal pumps along the rigid riser. This is currently the preferred method. Once at the surface, the nodules are separated from the leftover slurry. They are then dried out for transport to the mainland. However, the unwanted slurry that is left over needs to be piped down and expelled into the water column. This slurry is one of the primary environmental concerns of deep sea mining operations. Releasing at the top of the water column, where it can affect multiple levels of the ocean ecosystem, is not an option. At the very least, we need to pump the sediment down beyond the photic and dysphotic zones. These are the layers of the ocean that sunlight can reach. Pumping sun-blocking sediment above these layers would interfere with plankton and other photosynthetic organisms. An MIT study published last year investigated the dynamics of this sedimentation for both midwater dispersal and for the sediment dispersed by the harvester rovers. They found their models lined up closely with in-field experiments where they released sediment in exactly the same way off the coast of California. They found, thanks to the rapid dilution in the sea currents, that the sedimentation rate on the seafloor was drastically lower than normal background sedimentation, and thus should not interfere with filter feeders in the region. There was also no evidence of toxic elements in this extracted sediment. While it's tempting to compare this sediment to the toxic tailing pools we see in traditional ore extraction, these toxic waters are a byproduct of the ore processing. This part of the process does not happen at sea. This is simply surface sediment being returned to the sea. However, even if the plumes of waste product have minimal impact, mining operations have the potential to wipe out species we haven't even begun to study. Sea sponges use the nodules as anchor points. Deep sea octopus use them to lay and protect their eggs. And with these nodules taking millions of years to form, any surviving members of the species that depend on them would be left without a home, devastating an entire ecosystem which we have very little knowledge about, or its impact on the rest of the water column ecosystem. One of the few studies on the impact of these operations was conducted in the late 80s by a German government-funded research expedition off the coast of Peru. To assess the effects of nodule collection, they carved out trenches and removed nodules from an area 2 nautical miles in diameter. The first seabed disturbances were created in 1989, and after 33 years, the seabed floor has not recovered. The track can still be seen to this day. Filter feeders that depended on suspended food had a significant decrease in population, and affected areas showed lower biodiversity than controlled areas. Studies in other sites like the CCZ have also found a significant loss of life, up to 20% when compared to controlled areas. However, the sad truth is that the alternative is to mine these materials on land, which itself comes with environmental impacts. The vast majority of cobalt deposits lay under the lush forests of the Congo. To collect these metals, roads need to be built and forests need to be cut down. Another study compared the total emissions of both land and sea-based extraction methods and concluded that deep-sea mining of these nodules could reduce emissions by 80% for nickel, 76% for copper, 29% for cobalt, and 22% for manganese. These reductions are primarily driven by how these nodules are naturally occurring on the surface of the seabed, making extraction relatively low energy, and by the fact that ships are incredibly efficient at transporting loads. We also need to be incredibly conscious of the impending climate crisis. Ocean temperatures are rising, and with more and more carbon being absorbed into the oceans, they are slowly becoming acidic, killing off entire coral reefs. We need to transition to renewable energy as soon as possible, and these metals would accelerate this process. And there lies the dilemma that we, as the human race, have to ponder. Where do we collect the materials necessary to make a greener future? Is potentially destroying an unknown ecological system worth it to save the ones we know for a fact are in decline? Is it easier to find a new source of metals than to fix the problems with land-based mining? These are the questions we need to answer before exploiting this valuable resource in the deep, dark depths of our oceans. Climate change is the greatest challenge facing our planet, and we need more talented engineers and scientists working to solve this problem. That's why I talk about it so much on this channel, and why partnering with Brilliant to help educate the engineers of the future makes so much sense. We created our own real engineering themed course that you can take for free by signing up for their free trial. And if you found value in the math and science courses you took for free, and I'm sure you will, you can continue on with 20% off the annual premium subscription. Our in-depth interactive course teaches you about the physics of orbit and traditional rocket launches, before teaching you the fundamentals of kinetic launch systems, a course designed to help you understand spin launch, the subject of our recent documentary. You can get access to that course right now and all of Brilliant's other curated interactive courses by clicking the link in the description. One of my favorite courses on Brilliant is Programming with Python. Python is a versatile coding language and a fantastic first coding language to learn. It can be used for everything from video games to data visualization to machine learning. I used it to code custom scripts for engineering software for my master's thesis. I wish I had Brilliant back then to teach me the basics and to guide my learning, instead of trawling through textbooks. Brilliant teaches Python with interesting and fun interactive courses that challenge you along the way, making the learning process much easier and more rewarding. And they're adding content monthly, so there's always something new to learn. You can get started for free by clicking the link on screen now, and the first 500 people to do so will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription.